Our scripture for today comes from John 19, verses 38 through 42. Later, Joseph Arimathea as Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and oils, about 70 pounds, taking Jesus' body. The two of them wrapped it with spices and strips of linen. This was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden. And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid, because it was the Jewish day of preparation. And since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. I can hear Joseph, Arimathea, and Nicodemus saying, "You deserve it. Thanks be to God." The burial of Jesus shows us who was present during the roll call. The purpose of a roll call is not only to record the names of those who were in attendance, but it is also if a situation should occur. The people who were in attendance are subject to being called forward to give their account of the situation that happened. And what we know from the accounts of those on the roll call was that Jesus was buried and was supposed to stay put, but he didn't. In our scripture reading for today, the first person we see that was in attendance when the roll was called was Joseph Arimathea, a good and righteous man who was wealthy and noted as a secret disciple of Jesus Christ. Interestingly, while he was looking for the kingdom of God, he was regarded as a well-respected member of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish ruling council that was made up of a supreme political and religious body of leaders who had the highest authority in the ancient Jewish court system. The leaders were the Sadducees, who were the chief priest, and the Pharisees were the scribes. Joseph, who was a Pharisee, but his views about Jesus was not the same as the Pharisees. They believed in the resurrection and supported legal traditions, but not the ones ascribed in the Bible, but those traditions of their ancestors. This Jewish ruling council convicted Jesus of blasphemy. Blasphemy was taken very seriously, and the punishment was death. While Joseph was looking for the kingdom of God, his affection grew for learning the laws and customs of the Jews. He was looking, he was searching. And then, known to be exceedingly brilliant, he knew that when in Rome, do as the Romans do. So on today, I want you to think with me, never let the right hand know what the left hand is doing. Y'all with me? Joseph Arimathea was strictly against the enforcement of teaching Levitical laws in churches, and he was a staunch opponent of hypocrisy. Verse 38 says, later Joseph Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly because he feared the Jewish leaders. With Pilate's permission, he came and he took the body away. Later is to emphasize that this atrocity took place at night because of the disdain that the Sadducees and Pharisees had for Jesus. They wanted him arrested, they wanted him convicted, and they wanted him crucified quickly. Quickly, in the same day. I liken it to going through the drive-thru and ordering death. Jesus was arrested the night after the Passover meal, and during any time of the Passover festival, the governor of Rome, who was Pontius Pilate, could set free a prisoner chosen by the crowd. Because he was troubled himself by what the Jewish council had passed down on Jesus, to be put to death because of blasphemy, he asked the crowd whether they wanted Barabbas or Jesus set free. But by that time, the chief priests had persuaded the crowd to shout to Pontius Pilate, crucify him, set Barabbas free. Due to the fear of an uprising, Pilate washed his hands in front of the crowd and said, I am not responsible for the death of this man. Then all those in the crowd shouted, let the responsibility for his death fall on us and on our children. Then Pilate set Barabbas free and handed Jesus over to be crucified. However, when we look back over the roll call, we are reminded that Joseph was in attendance. He asked Pilate for the body of Jesus for three reasons. Number one, Joseph was an intellectual genius when it came to traditional laws and customs, Jewish laws and customs, and he knew the bodies of the executed were permitted from hanging on the cross overnight. Number two, anyone who is executed can only have a non-burial. Your name is not written anywhere. The location of your remains are not listed, because the body has been eaten by the beasts of the land and the birds in the sky. Joseph wanted to secure the body of Jesus to give it an honorable burial. And number three, Joseph wanted the body of Jesus because he knew that there was still some life in it. In other words, had it not been for Joseph, Arimathea, the resurrection would have never happened. There would be no having life and having it more abundantly. Oh, there would be no communion. Oh, thank God for people who have the courage to put on the full armor of God. Oh, never let the right hand know what the left hand is doing. Verse 38 says, Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jewish leaders. Oh, but when you listen more than you talk, you're labeled as timid and not tactful. When you keep your eye on the prize and not the problem, your predicament gets put on display and your purpose gets displaced. Oh, when they thought Joseph was scared of the Jews, I can hear the words in his mind saying, don't underestimate being underestimated. They can't stop you if they don't see you coming. I once read, a heap see, but only a few know. Verses 39 through 40 shows us that somebody else knew that the body of Jesus still had some life in it. Nicodemus. At first, he had wrestled with himself about the things that Jesus had told him because he was a Pharisee. But he changed his mind. In other words, he switched. When the Sadducees and the Pharisees began to condemn Jesus before he had a trial, it was Nicodemus that stood up and said in opposition, isn't it Jewish law that he should have a trial first? It was also Nicodemus who said to Jesus at night, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come for God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him. Oh, Nicodemus who brought the clean linen and the 75 pounds of myrrh and aloe, which was sweet scented wood made in a powdered form to reduce the odor of decay. Joseph and Nicodemus saw the sacrificial death of Jesus as one of humility. They witnessed love when they saw Jesus pay a debt that we couldn't pay. Their pride was pierced and their desires melted for power and prestige. In other words, it was the cross that made the difference in their lives. And seeing Jesus as the treasure in heaven, they swapped their treasures in the field for the treasure in heaven. Oh, you deserve it. They are the epitome of how transformative faith will guide you to turn towards Jesus, even when everyone else has turned away from Jesus. They knew that all the people who left after Jesus was crucified left too soon. They knew that when the people left after Jesus was crucified, they were signing out. Oh, but Jesus was signing in. The burial was their focus. The burial for Jesus that Nicodemus and Joseph had was suitable and honorable and righteous for a righteous king. Even though the night was approaching, they wanted the royal treatment of the body of Jesus to encapsulate Jesus' infinite work. They wrapped the body of Jesus in the sweet scented spices of myrrh and aloe in strips of linen. This was in accordance with a Jewish burial. Then they carried the body of Jesus to the garden. Oh, and the garden. It was 100 yards from the cross. It was owned and already prepared by Joseph Arimathea with a new tomb, never laid in, and protected by a heavy stone rolled against the opening. Oh, don't never let the right hand know what the left hand is doing. Oh, in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 9, and his grave was assigned with the wicked men, yet he was with a rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth. What's revealed in the context of this chapter was that Joseph had made the tomb for himself. Oh, but for some reason, an intellectual genius, I was thinking to myself, I believe that he knew that Jesus was only gonna need the tomb for the weekend. Don't underestimate being underestimated. They can't stop you if they don't see you coming. Joseph and Nicodemus honored Jesus in a way not known to man. They honored his lifeless corpse and gave it the life still in it, respect and undivided attention. Honor the infinite worth of Jesus by loving each other and not canceling each other. Honor the infinite worth of Jesus by being gentle to yourself. Honor the infinite worth of Jesus by unceasingly praying for all people and all things. And be thankful that in the first garden, death entered the world. Oh, come on, here's somebody. But in the second garden, death was defeated. The Bible says, though the mountains may be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed, says the Lord, who has compassion on you. Oh, you deserve it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. And amen. And amen.